Welcome back to another episode of With Sooner. We're very excited to be here with you today. This will be a very special episode. It's one of the last episodes of July, of course, but it's also, we have a very special guest joining us today, Tanner, who we'll talk a little bit about later. And before we get to all that, you know, just kind of quick lay of the land here. Back after the year, what we're seeing so far, truckload volumes are actually beginning to increase slightly. Nothing to write home about, but they are. It does seem like they are inching their way up. We've got rates still kind of stabilizing, nothing super special there. And then we're also beginning to see imports kind of trickle up a little bit as well. So lots to talk about and get to.
Yeah, absolutely. It's been interesting. I actually tweeted my July market update earlier today, and looking at obviously our bread and butter outbound tender volume index, it's pretty much been flat for about 9 months. I mean, very, very boring chart to look at this year so far. But interesting enough, like you mentioned earlier, Luke, since February, I think it was February 21st this morning, compared to this morning versus February, we're about 14% increase in outbound total volume. That's definitely no small thing.
That's notable. That's notable. And that's with rejections not going up at all. So that's really a real increase in volume. And what's interesting, too, is we're really starting to see, it almost feels like we're seeing the acceleration in the increase. If you notice that dark blue shaded line at the bottom there, volumes are starting to come up at a faster rate when traditionally, if you look at those previous years, even those pandemic years, minus the orange line, which is 2020, which doesn't count. We're going to throw that one out. But I mean, typically July starts to slow down. Like you see that there in 2019, which is the purple line. You see that in the green line, which is 2022. You even see it in the first half of July in 2021, which was a crazy COVID year. So, you know, typically July is going down. We almost never see the first half of July pick up like this. Very interesting to see. And it's going to be exciting to see, you know, is this just an anomaly and it's going to continue, or is this just a short period of time? We're going to find out.
Yeah, absolutely. And rejections just can't seem to make up their mind.
No.
3% for quite a while. Rejections is one of those data sets that likes to move a lot, right? It doesn't necessarily sit still, but it's been at 3% for a pretty long period of time. And so I think there's no way to correlate rejections of what's going on with volume. Like you mentioned, the port activity is really picking up, which I think has a lot to do with the recent pickup in the outbound tender. So it's going to be an interesting few months here.
Definitely is. Now, we've got to talk about this, too, because we're going to talk about a little bit more about some sonar data, but we also have to talk about, we've got a very special guest joining us here that we're going to bring on, Phil Schmidt-Bauer, who is a customer of Freightways, who you know quite well, but also, more importantly, he's actually the Senior Director of Analytics at ODW Logistics, and I believe has a lot of expertise when it comes to network optimizing, which, when you have a lot of fluctuating volumes and demands, that's an important job.
Yeah, absolutely. It should be at the forefront of every, honestly, customer's mind about network optimization and what carrier mix you're using and what, you know, how to efficiently have processes in place. And Phil is the man, the expert when it comes to that. So we'd love to go ahead and bring him on, introduce himself. Phil, how are you doing?
I'm doing well. How are you guys doing today?
Good. Doing really well. Really appreciate you taking some time to jump on with us here and ask a few questions with Luke and I. But first, I know you, but our audience doesn't. So if you don't mind maybe introducing yourself, talk a little bit about what you guys do at ODW.
Yeah, so I'm Phil Schmidbauer, Senior Director of Solutions Engineering and Analytics. And really our job, we're a full supply chain 3PL. And so what we do best is working together as a warehouse and transportation organization to optimize the supply chains of customers. And so we're working with a customer today. It's a recent carve out from a massive manufacturer. It's a huge brand that they've carved out of it. And our job is to stand up a DC in Columbus later on this year and then handle the transportation for them, right? So we're going through a ton of data right now, a ton of information, because we don't want to just manage the transportation or the warehousing separate. We need to understand the inbound flow of the product, how we're going to load in the warehouse, what the outbound is going to look like, and how we're going to mesh that with our other customers going into through our freight consolidation going out to the end customer. So there's a ton of work being done around this right now, but our goal is not just looking at optimizing your transportation, but are we doing it and best utilizing the warehouse and the resources they have and leveling out their workload, making sure that we don't have too many carriers, you know, the carrier usage going in certain lanes. So it's about optimizing the entire supply chain and understanding that we may cause some headaches on the warehouse the way we're scheduling freight to go out, but it's going to save money on the freight side, right? So it's about getting a total supply chain cost for our customers in line. And that also includes, before we do any of this work, making sure we're in the right location and warehousing in the right location. So that's really what we do, is just helping customers understand, are you set up for success geographically and the number of locations you have? And then how do we optimize the freight that's going to go in and out of those locations as we move forward with actual operations?
That's great. Phil, if you could too, just for some of our audience here who may be a lot newer to logistics and supply chain space, maybe just starting off their careers, right? When we say network optimization, we know what that means, but from their view, like why is it important? Why should they care about that?
Yeah, so a lot of it, I had a college course. I went to Central Michigan. We had a logistics management course. And it's funny because when I was in college in 2002, all of our coursework was designed around this, right? And our professor put it in front of us and we worked in groups on it. But look, you just think of Amazon. If you're an Amazon customer and you want your product within a day, and you live all over the United States, Amazon's got to have a ton of distribution centers with inventory all over the place in order for everyone in the U.S. or a certain majority of us to be able to get it overnight, right? Whereas in retail, when we deliver into retail locations, we deliver a lot of customers out of one location in Columbus, Ohio, and we reach the entire United States. And again, you have 10 to 14 day lead times to get it there. So network analysis is all about how many distribution points, how many products are in each of those distribution points, and it's a balance between cost and lead time. You know, how quickly do you need to service your customer, and then what's the best, most cost-effective way to do that? So it's a constant balance, and I tell people all the time, it's an art form. There is no black or white answer to these things. It's an art form, and you're just measuring and managing your risk based on your network.
Now, Phil, it's very easy to find a truck right now. The market's pretty soft. Capacity conditions aren't necessarily that tight. So is it more difficult to get customers to talk about network optimization when it's not really at the forefront of their minds? How do you get that stickiness going with them when really kind of everything's just easy right now?
Yeah. So from a network standpoint, people are always looking for ways to get better. You know, the customer that's carving out is carving out of a network that has 5 distribution centers right now. There's a lot of waste and a lot of difficulty in 5 distribution centers. So when you're doing a carve out, simplicity is key, right? You got to keep it simple. You're setting up new systems all across the board, new technology. You've got to keep things simple. So, but as far as talking to customers, it's all about that larger conversation around, and maybe within their network, they can't. If they're on a 5-year lease, they can't just uproot their network, right? So we support them there. So then we take the conversation out of the transportation optimization. And the way I like to look at it, and no matter what economy you're in, driving value for customers is always going to speak for itself. So it's not about, hey, I can save you a couple pennies on this lane rate or that lane rate. You have to take a customer's data and show them the value of optimization, whether it's a network optimization or a transportation optimization, where I'm just filling up and putting more on your trucks and building multi-stop truckloads. It's all about value. If we can deliver value, customers are going to listen.
Yeah, that's great context there, Phil. In your role, right, you mentioned that a lot of this is an art form, right? When we think about, you know, optimizing somebody's network, it's an art form, right? There's no perfect way to do it. There's no necessarily always one way to do it. But where does data play a part in maybe assisting the art, right? Are there certain data points that you should be looking at to understand maybe how it's performing? How do you think about that?
Yeah, no, that's a great question, and it is. It's all driven by data, and we're constantly even looking at our own data to make sure that that's accurate. So what we think we're putting on trucks and what we're designing based on the data flow, we go and audit that, right? And I learned that a long time ago in my days at the Toyota plant. Go look, go see. You have to go on the floor, make sure your audit's accurate. But then it goes down to like the sonar data that we use and making sure that we're understanding. And the way I put it is, we still have to make sure that our lane rates are competitive, right? Like, you don't have to be the cheapest when you can optimize well, because there's inherent cost in that. When I build a 2-stop truckload, it's not just an origin to destination rate. There's a stop-off fee, additional miles, a pain in the butt sometimes for drivers, so you pay a little bit more. But in the end, that data helps you get to the baseline of where to make sure you're still operating at good cost on the lane rates. And then there's all about key performance metrics. What's your trailer utilization look like? What's your additional leg miles? I've seen people do optimization and they put trucks together, or they put loads together that drivers just hate. Like, you have 3/4 of a day transit in between 2 stops. It's not even worth it, right? So that's the other part of the art form. And then measuring our performance on key performance indicators. How full are the trucks? What's our cost basis? We make sure that we're buying as close to market bottom as we can from a transportation standpoint. So there's a ton of data that goes into it and measuring your performance. And then I like to tell people, we don't want to just measure how we're doing. We want to go explain why there's changes in that key performance metric from week to week and month to month.
Yeah, Phil, and all that, it sounds like ODW really takes more of a consultative approach to a customer relationship rather than that transactional. Yeah. And I think we've seen that shift with the decline of the market. So, Phil, how important is it going to be for third-party providers moving forward to get away from that transactional sell and more move into that strategic consultative approach type relationship?
Well, I'm okay with fewer and fewer of them doing it. I mean, we'll just keep soaking up customers, you know, like it's great looking at data. And when I can look at a customer's data and they say, so-and-so is handling my freight. And I'm like, you guys shipped an LTL in the morning and an LTL to the same place in the afternoon that you could have put together on a truckload with something the following day. Right. So, I mean, as far as I'm concerned, it's great when people don't look at it like that, but they're just going to continue to get chewed up. I mean, you see a brokerage that goes out of business. You have to provide additional value outside of just booking a load at the cheapest rate, right? Like racing to the bottom on a lane rate isn't going to do anyone any good. And that's why I think ODW is successful in good times and in bad, because we really focus on driving value for customers. And this stuff's not easy. Like we've been doing it for years. I did it in my past. It's not easy to do, right? But as we continue to build processes and get better at it, we're just sticky with customers because we're continue to drive value for those customers.
Yeah, it's basically what Phil said is like, no, don't be consultative, be transactional. Yeah. That's the right way. And he'll just come in from behind with that audible.
Absolutely. And I think this, you know, that buzzword of like digital freight matching was such a big thing that's gone around. And interesting enough, I think I just saw FreightWaves article come out yesterday that the first decently sized broker actually filed bankruptcy, the first digital freight matching brokerage. Yes. And unfortunately, I do think we're going to see more of that to come. So I think you guys have a much larger opportunity ahead of yourselves in breaking into that. Now, Phil, we talked about using a little bit of sonar data here. I don't want to use it too much as infomercial, but you guys aren't just using sonar data, right? You've got all these different data points that you're using to make decisions with. I guess one thing that I hear a lot from other sonar customers is, hey, we've got all this great data, but what's most important is how we use it. So what are some of the parameters that you guys are setting around making sure that you're not necessarily using the correct data, but using the data that's going to ultimately lead you to be able to consult that customer?
Yeah, I mean, the key point with data is it's never perfect, right? It's never going to be perfect. So like, again, it's about having the data, going through a process, validating the data, and keeping an eye in the shifts in the data, right? So what's changing? You guys just showed that chart today and are talking about volumes being up. And I'd love to see that. I still think we have some murky waters ahead in the truckload market. Let's see what happens with Yellow and how this thing pans out over the coming weeks, and then see what your graphs are going to do from that standpoint, because you have a massive LTL carrier. If something happens there, you know, who knows what's going to happen. So for us, it's about looking at the data, understanding that it's not going to be perfect. And then to me, it's the big swings in data and understanding what's happening in those swings and how you can react. So, again, even managing data, there's no playbook on this. Everybody's going to use data differently. Everyone's going to rely on different sources of data. We have tons of different sources of data we look at. We have different systems we use and technology. And again, Tanner, it's fun looking at a customer's data and saying, you know what, I don't even care if I have the most competitive rate, because we're saving so much by putting this multi-stop truckload together. It doesn't matter what my rate is. Like, you guys are shipping air across the country. It doesn't matter. And that's really where you find a ton of savings in customers. Now, we have customers that ship full truckloads, point A to point B. Look, you know, you're shipping a bunch of water or a commodity, and that's all you can fit on a truck as a full truckload order. Sure, you know, race to the bottom on the rate on that freight. But when you're shipping a lot of larger LTLs or partial truckloads, there's just so much opportunity to optimize that freight.
So, Phil, I have to ask the question, right? The show's called With Sonar. So if you had to pick, do you have a favorite sonar data point that you like to look at?
Yeah, I mean, tender rejects is always interesting to look at. Looking at that chart, just understanding what carriers are doing in the market, and is that predictive going up and down? So that's kind of one. I like when you guys put together the charts and send me the email and kind of read it out to me, so I don't have to go through and dig through it and interpret it all myself. That's always fun too. But yeah, I like tender rejects, and that's one I mean, when we first started with you guys, and honestly, I was one of the, when Kyle called on us, I was one of the guys that was like, I don't know what we're going to do with this data. I don't know that we understand it. And over time, like it just became a gradual thing to get into it. So that's probably my favorite.
That's a good one. Yeah, we've been looking at that one a lot. Tanner, I know you mentioned that. You were tweeting out a little bit about all the changes that have happened to it, right? It's off its bottom, but not by a lot. And it's trying to figure out, you know, which direction it wants to go right now. And so far, the elevated volumes haven't had much of an impact on it, which means that there's plenty of capacity to handle that elevated volume right now. I say elevated volume compared to where we were.
Yes.
Yeah. Context is key. But
yeah, and I mean, I think to your guys', you know, you think about from a capacity standpoint, we haven't seen a whole lot happen with carriers, right? So you see a broker going out of business and going bankrupt, but we haven't seen a whole lot on the asset-based front. Yeah. So it'll be interesting to see how the demand and supply of this, you know, of trucking goes over the coming weeks and months.
Yeah, well, the barrier to entry for a carrier is so low. Like, just because a carrier, let's say a 50-truck carrier goes out of business, like, those guys just, they don't leave the industry and go, you know, work at a warehouse or a restaurant or something. They're just going to sit in another driver's seat for another company. So just because a truck says that they closed down doesn't necessarily you can leave the market. So I think it's really, really difficult to try to see that capacity leave. But you mentioned Yellow, right? It sounds like the UPS thing got sorted out yesterday, so that we might have got saved there. But still, if Yellow does file bankruptcy, I would expect that we would see that start to make an impact, certainly in the LTL market, but I do believe that it might bleed over to the truckload market.
It could definitely bleed into the truckload market. I mean, they've got over 14,000 trucks and 30 some odd thousand trailers, right? That's definitely going to impact truckload to some extent. But yeah, I mean, it'll be interesting to see exactly. I think you're right. They won't all go away. Some will go see another truck. But when you have a company of that size, it's going to take time for that transition to happen. So
yeah.
We'll keep an eye and see if they do end up going out of business or filing for bankruptcy or doing a restructure or whatever happens. We'll have to keep an eye on rates. We'll keep an eye on tender rejections, keep an eye on volumes and see if there's any potential impact there. But I'd say, you know, Phil, I guess from your perspective, right, you know, a question I always like to ask folks, right? You've been in the industry for a bit. You've got a lot of great experience, right? What's a bold prediction you would make for the industry that not necessarily that you expect to come true per se, but maybe something you'd like to see happen over the next 3 to 5 years?
Oh, man, that's a good question. You know, I'm just finishing up reading George Friedman's book when he talked at the last Sonar event, you know, and the one about his geopolitical discussion. And I'm just finishing up his book and he makes some very good points. And while I think they're going to impact transportation, they're not direct. And one that I've been saying for years is the student loan bubble. And that's one that he talks about, that thing's getting ready to burst. In September, I think people have to start paying that. So when you talk about the impact on the transportation industry, I think it's just a matter of what happens with the economy, right? And I feel like the transportation industry sees things first. I don't know what's going to happen with digital freight brokerage. I think, again, I go back to we kind of shift over to automation and then less automation. And there's a lot of talk about AI. And there was a lot of talk also about blockchain. And I haven't heard anybody talk about blockchain in a while. So as far as bold predictions, my bold prediction is that driving value for customers is going to continue to be a fad, whether in whatever technologies we have to bring in to do that. Some technology is going to come in and like George talks about in his book, we're getting ready to have two cycles end at the same time here in the late 2020s. You know, so going into 2030, and I think there's going to be a huge shift in both, and like he predicts, there's going to be a huge shift in the way that we operate with our government, and the way that we operate as individuals with people, right, and how we react to each other. And so, the one thing I know for sure, supply chain is going to continue to be in demand. We're going to continue to move products, and we're going to probably have major disruptions every couple of years leading up to 2030. So the next major disruption could be another pandemic. It could be a war. Who knows? But something's going to happen. It always does.
Yeah, that's a great call, Phil. That reminds me of something I heard. It reminds me of an interview I heard of Jeff Bezos says, and they were saying, "What's the next technology?" And he says, "I have no idea." But he says, "I'm pretty sure consumers will still want to have their goods as quickly as possible and as cheaply as possible without sacrificing quality."
Yeah,
better, faster, and cheaper. Better, faster, and cheaper. It's what I learned in college, and it has not changed.
Has not changed.
Good deal. Phil, thank you so much for taking some time to join us today. I'm sure we will have you back on and hope to see you. We will see you in November, right? At F3 in Chattanooga.
Yeah, I'm signed up in November. We'll see you down there and hope to talk to you guys before.
Good deal. Thanks for joining.
Thanks for joining, Phil.
Thanks for having me.
Take
guys.
Care. That's some good stuff. It's all about figuring out a way to optimize somebody's network. I like what he said, right? You know, I think we get into this tug of war a lot of times. Is the answer data? Is the answer art, right? Is it experience? But it's not one or the other. It doesn't have to be one or the other.
No, it doesn't. I think it's a mix of both, actually, right? And I think that's one thing that I hear this a lot from Sonar customers. What you've heard it a lot from guests on Sonar repeatedly is it's you can go out and purchase all the data in the world that you want to and say that you've got all the data, mm-hmm. but it's really about how you use it and then the way that you use it that truly makes you successful. And I think ODW has found a way to do that.
Speaking of data, I want to bring up one more data point here on with Sonar before we part ways. This is going to be wait times, okay? So we don't look at this chart a lot, but it is a nice one to look at. So this is just over the last year. These are wait times in minutes that trucks are waiting at facilities. Now, mm-hmm. there's maybe times that trucks are waiting at the facility to get loaded, so this may not necessarily be active load or unload time. Although that is included, it includes the time that they enter the facility. So they may be waiting at the facility before they even get to the dock doors. Right now, it's about 117 minutes, a nice little drop from where we were just about 2 weeks ago, which makes sense. That was we had some holidays going on 2 weeks ago. Not sure if anybody's aware, but a little something called 4th of July. And we've come down a little bit since then, which is to be expected. So we ran up towards the holiday. It looks like we're coming back down. But 117 minutes. Again, includes load and unload time, but also includes time just at the facility. And we've pulled out any outliers of trucks that would just be sitting there overnight or something like that. But all in all, for the most part, wait times have come down this whole year. You know, they started the year around 125 minutes, and they've been steadily declining. That's a positive for truckers.
No, it is a positive, right? Like, you have limited amount of time per day, mm-hmm. per week, per month, per year that you can run and operate your truck, and the least amount of time you spend sitting at a dock, that means you get to run more miles. I'm surprised that this data set actually hasn't declined a little bit even further over a longer period of time, right? Yeah. You and I have talked about it, like, in efficiency improvements, right?
Yeah.
Kind of like how you're loading a truck and how many trucks and who's working on the floor on the warehouse, right? So I'm a little surprised, and it looks like we got all the way up to, like, what is that, 100, almost 130, 140
yeah.
minutes? I can't see the chart very
well. Had we gone back, like, about a year and a half, 2 years ago, I mean, you're flirting with 140 minutes at
yeah.
one point.
That's over.
But believe it or not, 117 minutes is one of the best it's been. Now, you have to remember, this is across the entire country, all
yeah.
warehouse types. So, you know, you've got some of those highly specialized stuff that's going to, you know, increase it. You've got some stuff that's a lot speedier that's going to decrease it. So, you know, depending on the industry, some industries are performing a lot better than others. So this is a cumulative average. I'd love to see it under 100 minutes. We'll see if we get there one day, but hopefully we'll. Anyways, folks, it's been a great episode. We'll see you next week live on WithSonar, 3 p.m. on Wednesday. Stay tuned. There's a lot more FreightWaves content to come. And, of course, be thinking about the November FreightWaves event here in Chattanooga, F3. It's going to be an absolute banger. You're not going to want to miss it. Have a fantastic rest of your day.